My memory is too short. Gradually, I'm thinking that I'm losing credibility to teach because things are going out of my hand. Become too. Okay, bring foreign exchange, then increasing purchasing power of citizen, improve quality of life of citizen, earn foreign exchange, what not? There's so much. Reliance Industries contributes about 10% of direct tax. Imagine if there would be 20 Reliance. 20 Reliances, our GDP will triple. And then Reliance Jio alone contributes directly to 5.65% of our GDP. That was told by a Harvard Business Review study, and that was in 2018. I think I showed 6% in some mail. So correct it. It is 5.65%. Imagine that we have many more such companies. What would be the impact of the GDP? Listen carefully. This is slightly cluttered and complex. This shows industrial revolution. We are in the fourth industrial revolution. If you are not familiar, the first industrial revolution started somewhere at about 1770s, 1784, 1884, 85, 86, when steam engine came into being, and just before that, when the first cotton gin, it may not be GIN, I wrote GIN, it may be GENE or something, meaning when the first cotton yarn making machine came into being. Earlier, it was a luttai kind of a thing, a very crude tool, hand tool, whereas this started in 1776. So 1776, 1784, this is the time when the first industrial revolution started, because first mechanization and first secondary power was used as a steam engine. Before that, about 5 million years, we were using only hand tools, or maybe at the later part, we domesticated some of the animals. And we could that you can construe that as secondary power if you consider animal power as secondary power. Then came some of the automobile and IC engine and many more things, gas, oil, coal, etc., etc., that gave rise to second industrial revolution, when mass production like Ford started the people car, blah blah. Then came PLC, programmable logic control. That gave rise to a lot of automation, even robotic manufacturing and whatnot. Biotechnology also came. Genetically modified crop started coming, like the what is that in US, that maize was genetically modified, and that revolutionized American economy. Many things actually revolutionized. That is one of them. Then came cyber physical system, blockchain, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and whatnot. Nowadays, whatever you see, this is part of industrial revolution, particularly IoT and things like that. Why this slide is here? Because you need to understand two things. One, we took 5 million years for migrating into or transforming ourselves from a hand tool driven economy to a mechanized economy. Then it took about 100 years or so for us to come to maybe automobile and other things. Then it takes hardly few years for us to go into automation. Then it became even shorter, meaning the change actually is accelerating. Change is not constant. So you never know what is going to come next year. Earlier, for 100 years, people used to think this is life, like the parents and their children used to see the same technology over and over again. Whereas today, what you are kind of exposed to at your early age, we are exposed to that at our fag end. You may not understand how things were there during our childhood. You should try to understand, and then you'll realize how fast things are changing. And change makes two things. One is it complicates the existing system. It creates complexities. Because suppose you have some IoT-based solution and you think that this is the most latest technology and you feel complacent, you don't invest in research and development, you don't innovate. tomorrow you wake up to see that a new technology has come and your business has become redundant. That is number one, and that is why many companies are dying. Those who are not innovative, they are dying. Second is, it throws opportunities. You are exposed to new technology and you think that you can disrupt a particular industry using the new technology. So that gives you opportunities. And that is why opportunities are coming every day. If you think that, oh my God, most of the industries are done and I cannot think of something new, that is your limitation. You should come out of that box. You should come out of that boundary. Every day new opportunities are unfolding and you should be able to, you know, lay your hands on all of that to create new businesses. And that is why businesses are dying day in and day out and new businesses are coming on. Just to show you, Industry 4.0. We are in Industry 4.0 and many, many things actually constitute Industrial Revolution 4.0. Where are we? This is a very significant component of today's discussion. I get carried away. The age effect. That is why I talk too much about too many things. But if you do not think that way, if you think that positively that these are bundle of information that makes a person matured, then you will gain a lot of things. That's what I believe. That is why I don't modify myself. So where are we in this landscape? Meaning that, why are we at the forefront? Are we at the back end or lagging behind or struggling? Where are we? And why are we so? Now, some history. Listen very carefully. Many of you may not be aware about this. Many of you may not even trust this. But these are data. I hope there are references somewhere. You just see the slides, you'll get the reference. Historically, in the year 1, when the Gregorian calendar started, and before that, India's economy was the largest in the world. India contributed 33.75% of global GDP. No, that is billion dollar. 32% of global GDP. It cannot be so accurate. India contributed 32% of global GDP, and the remaining 68% were contributed by the rest of the world. Out of the 68%, China also contributed another 32%. So 64% were contributed by these two nations. 64, that means 36% was the world economy minus India minus China. That was the India's condition, the situation. Then in the year 1000, it came down to 28%. From there, it came down to something like 1.5% in the year 1990. That data is not here. What happened? There were so many invasions. You know, because India was rich, there was so much of wealth in India. And people from rest of the world targeted India for occupying and robbing and taking the wealth from here back to their nation. So name any superstar of the previous years, you will find that they always try to come to invade India and become heroes, something like that. And particularly during the British period, I don't know if I have that slide. No, I don't have. I'll show you some other time. In fact, I need to show actually. Let me see how much time I take. I'll show you that. That is very important. I wanted to have them, but somehow I did not put it there. Where it might be. There is something called keynote speech. Wherever I deliver keynote speech, normally I show that slide, other departments. So he is not there. Mechanical, sorry, I'm lost. Personal. it should be here. So recently I delivered a lecture at, this is the lecture. This is very important, that is why I'm taking so much time. So I have to now unshare this one and then share the other one. So yeah, I wanted to show this graph. Not big, but then it will drive home the point. Look at the British economy. British economy was nowhere. It was close to $0 billion. If from 1270, I have the graph from 1270, I have the source also given, GDP in England using BOE, Bank of England. Bank of England data cannot be doubt this data, because it is about Britain and British only gave us this data. See, in the year 1700 something, they started growing. You can always argue that this is when Industrial Revolution started, but then this is when they invaded India and Indian economy. Look at this green line. Indian economy was going downhill, precipitously downhill, and British economy was a steep up, just almost like a vertical line. So you can very well understand that they exploited Indian economy and created wealth for themselves, and that is how they became like that. So let us share the other one. This one. Yeah, we were here. I hope you can see. Yeah. Okay, so it's not going into presentation mode, right? So now China and India is juxtaposition. So you can see that we were neck to neck. Of course, this is from 1400. 1400, China contributed 30% of global GDP. We contributed only 25%. But look at 1700, ours was 24%. So it was sometimes China more than us, sometimes we more than China. Even in 1990, China, India contributed equal portion in global GDP, whereas China has moved far ahead. In 2015, China contributed 17%, India contributed 9%. This is on purchasing power parity basis, another is something. So this is, I think, purchasing power parity basis. Whatever, forget about that. It is because why this happened and why I am so this thing about the British. When British came here, they looted majority of most of our wealth. Not only that, our artisans were the best in the world. Our textile was best in the world. In fact, French, British and German textile companies were not able to compete with Indian artisans. And that is why they always wanted to destroy our artisans, our industry, our whatever, if you call them industry, and then compete. Sorry. In fact, the first stock market was set up in an European small nation. And the first company to be listed was East India Dutch Company. So it's an Indian company, meaning the Dutch promoted the company, but it was based out of India. It was exploiting Indian wealth, and they were listing in Luxembourg. Luxembourg is the country. So it was the first stock market and the first stock to be listed anywhere in the world for the first time was East India Dutch Company. So we have, okay, forget about that part. Now, what I wanted to tell you that the rest of the world promoted entrepreneurship through innovation, and we remained under siege by the British and others. That is why we were always running for our life, for our safety. That is why we love gold, because we used to always carry gold, because we knew that whether currency have any value or not, gold will always have value. Forget that. So the point that I'm trying to drive home here is that through entrepreneurship, America, Europe, and all other countries, even Japan after Second World War, through entrepreneurship and innovation, they built their economy, they defeated India gradually, and now we are at the cross, we are at the threshold of growth, and with the right kind of government policies, it is the right time to start a company. If somebody doesn't start now, he or she will find it difficult moving forward. This is already discussed. Now, there are many myths about this. One is entrepreneurs are born and not made. Absolutely wrong. Dhrubhai Ambani was born in a family. His father was a school teacher, very poor school teacher, and he did not have 2 square meal. He had to sell potato chips in the market when he used to go to school, class 5, 6, 7, 8. He could not go to high school because his father could not afford money. So he had to migrate to Aden as a petrol pump operator. That was Dhirubhai Ambani, Narayan Murthy, Suril Bharati Mittal, Sabir Bhatia, Steve Jobs, John D. Rockefeller, Andrew Carnegie. None of them inherited business. None of their families were business families. They were all born poor, absolutely poor, except Sunil Bharati Mittal. His father was a Rajya Sabha member. Sabir Bhatia was working in US. I don't know about his parents. Sound ekdom. Just mute karo. Off karo aage. Now, click karo na jekhane shekhane. Where was I? Okay, none of their family had anything. John D. Rockefeller was absolutely poor. He could not eat 1 square meal a day, something like that. We'll talk about their stories later. Another myth is that it takes a lot of money to start a business. 80% of the business are bootstrap, meaning that they have some money in the savings bank account, 5,000, 10,000 or something. They borrow 5, 10,000 from friends, and that is how they manage. Entrepreneurs are born in business families? Absolutely not. In fact, if somebody is born in business families, they will have a lot of baggage, emotional baggage, managerial baggages, because they cannot come out of those old philosophies. Of course, there are exceptions. So let us not be too obsessed about that part. Entrepreneurs are extrovert? Absolutely not. But if you're extrovert, don't think that you cannot be entrepreneur. But many entrepreneurs are introvert. Now, there will be many failure stories. In fact, I will give you a lot of data where I'll show you that 90% of the entrepreneurs are failing. Then this data should not actually make you nervous, meaning they should not be looked at menacing at you. There are many reasons why people fail, and most of the reasons can be averted. If you know why people are failing, only that itself will help you to avert many of the failures. So there is always a possibility that you can avert failure and become successful. 42% of the people start a business to do something that nobody wants, meaning they are like IIT students. They sit in their hostel room and then look at the internet. They think that, oh, this guy is doing this, so I can do that. And there is no reason why people will not buy my product. This doesn't work that way. Majority of the people think that way. They go to market. After developing the product, they spend a lot of money and time. And then one fine morning, they go to market to realize that customers are not liking it. So what can be done to avoid that? You have to get your product ideas validated at the early stage. Whenever the idea is there in your mind, you have to talk to some potential customer, to your friends, to your parents, to others. Tell them, will you buy this if I make? Then gradually you have to repeatedly get validated as you keep on making prototypes. If you are making some portal, you make a wire drawing of the portal, and then many of the whatever services you are going to give, you try to give one by one, and then try to realize whether people are liking. Likewise, there are many reasons which can be averted absolutely if you are knowledgeable about this, and that is why this class is there. Now, Charlie Munger once said, all I want is where am I going to die? If I know where I'm going to die, in my lifetime, I'll never go there. So God will not be able to kill me, because God has a plan. God wants me to die in Kolkata. So I'll never go to Kolkata. So I'll never die, because I'm going to cheat God. Why this joke? Why this adage, this quotation? Meaning that if you know why people are dying, why companies are failing, if you know them, you are not going to commit the mistake and you are not going to fail. Okay? Now, Bill Gross is a billionaire. He's not just one billionaire. He promoted more than 100 companies. At least 10 of them are billion-dollar company. Any company whose valuation is $1 billion, it's called unicorn. If it is $10 billion, it's called decacorn. So Bill Gross promoted many unicorns and some decacorns. And if he tells something, then we have to take it without pinch of salt, meaning we have to accept that. Because he started more than 100 companies, maybe 70 of them failed. If anybody has started a company and failed, he or she has a lot of experience to share. So you know why it failed and you will not commit that mistake. Bill Gross failed many times. Bill Gross succeeded many times. So whatever he says carries weight. He says timing is the most important factor for success of a business. Suppose you start a face mask manufacturing company. COVID timing is the most important time. Before that, it would not be successful. After that, you will have less buyers and more competition because so many companies are coming up. Victor Hugo once said, this is about timing. Means the whole slide is about timing. Victor Hugo said, There is one thing in this world which is more powerful than the entire army of this universe. And what is that? That is an idea whose time has come. If you hit upon an idea and its time is just the right time, that idea will create so much wealth and it will disrupt the existing industry so drastically that this is the most powerful thing. That's what they wanted to mean. And why present time is so very important, you all know already. Can we compete or is it just a pipe dream? We definitely can. In the global business parlance, marketplace, if you think that Indian technologies are still yet to evolve, think again. Hero Motors, Bajaj, TVS, wherever they go, Chinese run for their money. The Chinese started marketing their motorcycles in South Africa. Bajaj, TVS and Hero went there. Chinese shut down their shop. Chinese bikes came to India thinking that they will destroy the two-wheeler industry in India by selling cheaper bikes. Initially, we thought, my God, they're giving a motorcycle for 30,000 rupees with features that will cost something like 1 lakh rupees if it is from Bajaj or any other Indian companies. Now, even for museum, you won't get a Chinese two-wheeler in India, Indian market. Same thing in many other marketplaces, Brazil, Argentina, then Middle East, they are being dominated by Indian companies. So, though Indian companies were depending on Japanese technology, now they themselves are self-sufficient. TVS doesn't have collaboration with Suzuki any longer. Bajaj also doesn't have collaboration with Bajaj. What is the collaborator? Not Suzuki. Bajaj. Hero had, all of them had collaboration. Hero was Honda. Hero, Honda, Bajaj, something. Whatever. So now they are self-sufficient, they are churning out technologies and they are challenging their own parents. India has become the global pharmaceutical capital, what not. Several Indian companies, even for vaccine, you already know that two vaccines have already got approval some 2 days back. So if this way of development continues to happen, we are going to create so much wealth, we are going to supply vaccine, not only vaccine, the treatment also. In fact, India already have come up with treatment, medicine for COVID treatment, not just vaccine. So India is going to earn billions of dollars. And if this continues, we will be leaving China behind within 10 years. 10 years should be, you know, we should not think that we are going to do it tomorrow. We are so far behind that we cannot dream of doing something like that. If you think that, do I have the elements to create a venture and successfully run? The answer lies there. Unless you start, you will never know. Nobody in the world can tell you whether you will become a successful entrepreneur or not. Lest you yourselves. Unless you start, you will never know whether you can really, really start a company. Look at this guy, John C. Maxwell. He said, if you are not failing, you are not at all moving, meaning you are standstill, that is why you are not failing. If anybody is doing anything, he will definitely fail. If anybody tells you that, I never failed in my life, you can amply rest assured that this guy did not do anything in life. Or maybe he used to take orders from people. He used to fail and used to tell that these people who ordered me, they failed. So it is natural to fail. It is absolutely natural to fail. But then fail early, fail often, but always fail forward. That's what he said. Learn this sentence very carefully. There will be multiple questions in almost every test. You will find this last line or maybe first line. Fail early, meaning suppose you are developing a product. Now, suppose the product development life cycle is 2 years. So instead of failing at the end of 2 years, if you know that you are going to fail eventually, then it is better to fail today and save the money, time, resources for the rest of the 2 years. How we are going to do that? That is the mantra. That is the, you know, smartness that you have to demonstrate. You have to understand whether this is going to fail through validated learning that we will talk about when we talk about lean startup, lean product development, and many more things. Fail often, meaning that fail quickly. Don't wait for failing or something. Meaning that you try repeatedly. Don't, you know, fail and then again take some time, start another, somewhat slowly, etc., etc. Not that. Fail often means you just fail quickly and be smart. Whenever you fail, learn from your failure. That is the most important part of this sentence. But always fail forward, meaning don't fail and give up. If you fail and give up, you fail backward. You fall flat. Those are the most coward people who fail and they don't have the energy to fight back because they don't learn from failure. Smart people, they fail early, fail often, but they learn from failure, they restart, they don't commit the same mistake. It's not necessary that you fail early. You failed once, you will not fail again. You will fail often, but you will not commit the same mistake over and over again. You may commit another mistake. Thomas Alva Edison said, if I have failed 10,000 times to build something, I did not fail. Why? Because I discovered that this cannot be solved using those 10,000 methods. So the solution lies outside those 10,000. So I'll be trying something else and someday I am going to pass. I am going to succeed. And that is why Thomas Alva Edison had so much of success. You know, General Electric was promoted by Thomas Alva Edison and many other companies. Entrepreneur, I already defined. It is like entrepreneurship within another enterprise. Like say, I talked about Google. If you join Google, they will tell you that 20% time belongs to you. They will give you infrastructure, a separate room, anything, money, mentorship, using which you should be able to you know, use your creative talent and come up with something new, and then you can sell it to anybody, to Google or some other party. You can earn billions. You can start a company with the technology. So sky's the limit. Why people do that? Why Google will be doing that? Two reasons. One is creative. It is very difficult to keep creative people at one place. They are very, meaning, restless. So they will be joining a company. Then they'll, after a while, this company is no good. They cannot exploit my creative talent, or maybe they are traditional thinkers. They don't empower me to do something. If I tell my boss that I want to do something, my boss will say, this is not your job. Your job is, you know, planning from 10 to 5, just do that, not beyond that, something like that. But here you have been given an atmosphere. You have been empowered to think, etc., etc. So you cannot, you know, blame anybody for that. Second is, I said two reasons. Second reason is that by doing this, the companies are reaping another benefit. That is, nowadays, even Google-like companies are challenged by startup. I have already told you. Even Facebook was challenged by WhatsApp. WhatsApp was another startup and it did not have so much of money. They were looking for funding, etc. Similarly, Google also is looking for challenges from startups. Now, if those startups are already creating new knowledge within the company, then they will save them their future challenges, future threats. Because these guys are going to create new knowledge. Just a second. The class is you. What are you talking about? So these people will come up with disruptive new innovations, and eventually Google will know what is happening. They will give good price to these people and get this access to these technologies. Now, Anand Shanwal is an Indian, but he maintains a company called CB Insight. You should visit cbinsight.com. There are a lot of new information and many, many things. So this is the last slide. You just read them later. I placed it yesterday only. So they have, all those successful companies have one thing in common. But then what I was telling is CB Insight is a website where you get a lot of information, particularly this slide on why companies fail. It is from CB Insight website. In fact, anybody and everybody who are talking about the reasons for failure, they are definitely referring to their data. So read them. So all companies are resorting to innovation, and that is giving them the advantage. They all have a strong business moat. Okay, moat, I don't want to discuss now. Moats will be discussed later. Let me just move to the next slide. Let me just initiate, otherwise I'll never be able to even start that lecture. At least let me start. And this is just stories. So this is a story, so nothing big about it. Even if I don't discuss, you can always read. But I'll definitely discuss. So there are some stories about entrepreneurship. The first stories. Before I go to the stories, more important means the succinct part that I want you to get from here, meaning the takeaways from these stories are the takeaways. What do you take away from these stories? What they tell you about success of business. Dhirubhai Ambani started his life in abject poverty. If he would not have done potato chips business in the local marketplace or roadside, his family would not be able to get 2 square meals, something like that. That was the real situation. But then he created the most valuable company in India. Karshan Bhai Khudidas Patel, he started Nirma, but before starting that, he was just a lab assistant, and he came up with a formula for low-cost detergent. He used to sell those detergent on his bicycle. Now Nirma is a multi-billion dollar company. Kalpana Saroj is a real slumdog millionaire. She also started her life in absolute misery, and eventually she became a multimillionaire. We'll talk about her story as well. Sophia Amoruso is a foreign story, is an American story. Rags to riches story, we'll see that later. Dhirubhai Ambani, the whole story is here. Entrepreneur par excellence. You see some of his activities, you will be surprised that without much engineering or management education, he could create so much of wealth. This data should be revisited. It's not 10 lakh crore. I think today it is 20 lakh crore. This data is old data because Reliance has already got something like $28 billion from Facebook, from many other companies, and the valuation has gone through the roof, and it is, I think, 20 lakh crore rupees or something. All these data are slightly old data. As on 28/11/2019, I have to get the data and update. Maybe I'll do it in the next semester. Now, perhaps this second round of data perhaps may not be available. Okay, now look at some of the thing. Born in a poor family, son of a village school teacher. He used to retail cooking oil and onion potato fry at the local village market during weekend. He was highly intelligent, that's more important. High physical, mental energy, strong willpower just for life, that is most important part. Could undertake difficult activities, and he could always compete without looking back. But then his dad suddenly fell sick and he had to migrate to Aden. Aden is in Yemen. This is the place where it is the capital. Capital of Yemen is Aden. And that was the port which is highly lively because it was the connectivity between the east and the west in those days. Let us not go into all those. So he was a petrol pump operator, but then later he could get a managerial job in a Shell company. Shell means the petroleum company. He had always been a knowledge seeker. This is the most important part. He was a knowledge seeker. Look at what kind of knowledge he used to seek. One is export-import knowledge, commodity trading, marketing, distribution, currency trading, and money management. This he used to learn during tiffin hours, weekends, and during night time. He never used to spend a minute dilly-dallying or chit-chatting or anything. He had a vision that I will start a refinery back in India. He wanted to come back to India with a lot of money, start a refinery because he was a manager in some section of a refinery by Shell. So he was learning all these that someday I will be needing information about export, import, commodity trading. Came to India only recently, maybe 5 years back or 6 years back. But in those days, he used to learn commodity trading, marketing, whatnot. Then he learned trading skill and made exclusive contacts. This is another important feature of entrepreneur. You network with people, because if you start a business and if you want to run it successfully, you will require help from Tom, Dick, Harry, whosoever you know. They are going to handhold for their own benefit, but then you will get advantage. And unless you have connectivity, it's very difficult to manage. He extended free service to Gujarati community to learn accounting. Look at the mentality. He learned banking, insurance, shipping documentation for export, import, etc., etc. During lunch hours, he used to engage in commodity trading so that he can learn better. And during weekend, he used to learn English. Now, whatever, he became manager. This is the time he became manager. He wanted to come back here and start a refinery. While doing a market research, he realized Indian exporters, he started doing spice trading. Then later he diversified into cotton trading. But then he realized that Indians have a mentality to make more money by selling poor quality stock. And you know, they didn't have any efficiency or customer service philosophies. So he identified that one is quality. I must assure quality to my customer and timely delivery. Quality and timely delivery. And eventually he could get a toehold in the business. And not only that, he started communicating directly with the retailer so that he can make a short cut. He can bypass the middlemen, because middlemen were trying to sabotage his business. So he could bypass them by direct connectivity with the retailer or meal owners. There he used to say, profit I share, loss is mine, profit I share. Meaning that if there is a loss, that is mine. But if I make profit, I am going to share with you. Even though I am selling you at a price and I have every right on this price. But by selling this, if I make some profit, I will transfer some profit to you. But if I ever make loss, I am going to bear that loss. So likewise, I'll just mention one more thing and then call it quit. He introduced, okay, what, look at his business acumen. I defined entrepreneurship by saying that entrepreneurs are those who can create, who look for opportunity, or he can create opportunity in adversity. How Dhirubhai did that? There was a time in India when the foreign exchange reserve went down to almost zero. There was no money, foreign exchange. Then government of India told that only those people will be able to import who can earn foreign exchange. Indian textile industry was dependent on foreign, on dollar, particularly synthetic, because synthetics were not, at that time there was no petroleum refinery. So there was no polyester plant or anything. The technology was also not there. So India declared that if you can earn foreign exchange, only then you can import. So many, many people shut their business because they did not have the foreign exchange. Dhirubhai Ambani identified an opportunity in that adverse situation. In the adverse situation, when people are running away, they are shutting shops. What Dhirubhai did, he exported cotton at a loss to earn foreign exchange. With that foreign exchange, he imported synthetic variety of textile. And he sold just like a monopolist and earned handsome profit. So look at the business acumen. He sold at a loss, but then eventually he made super profit. So that is how, this is a great example of identifying an opportunity in adversity. He introduced a shiny variety of variety called Bambar in Indian market, and Indians were crazy about shiny variety, and that is how he became more successful. Let me complete just the Dhirubhai story. This I have already discussed. Okay, I'll start from here in the next class. This is just the contribution. Next part is question by Kodidas Patel. We'll talk about him and others in the next class. I'll try to catch up. I have to talk to my HOD. He called me. I promised him to touch base at 10 o'clock. So I'll just a second, wait for a while. I'll take the attendance first, then you leave. Yeah, it's done. I got the attendance. Yes. Thank you very much.